Hello everyone, Professor Poepping here. I'd like to take the time to have a closer look at the time graphs for position, velocity, and acceleration, as they're very helpful in solving physics motion problems. Let's look at three key scenarios and the corresponding time graphs for position, velocity, and acceleration. To get us started, the first row is for a stationary object. Stationary means that the position is constant or unchanging in value. The slope of this position time graph is zero, corresponding to our velocity being zero. And the slope of the velocity time also being zero indicates an acceleration of zero. Next, we have uniform motion. By definition, an object moving uniformly means it has a uniform or unchanging velocity. Thus, its position is changing linearly in the positive direction, for this example with a positive constant velocity. Notice that the slope of the position time graph is given by delta x over delta t, which we should recognize from the definition of velocity. Similarly, the slope of the velocity time graph is given by delta v over delta t, which we recognize as the definition of acceleration. Here, the slope of the flat or constant velocity line is zero. In other words, the acceleration is zero. Lastly, we look at motion with constant acceleration. We should recognize that constant acceleration means a constant change in the velocity. This means a straight line for the velocity time graph, with a constant positive slope here reflecting the constant positive acceleration. The linearly increasing velocity also tells us that motion starts with a slope or a velocity of zero, and the positive slope increases as we move along in the positive direction. So our position is a quadratic function of time. What if we started with an initial velocity? Pause and predict what the position curve would look like. This says that we're already in motion at t equal to zero, so we have a non-zero slope at t equal to zero. It would be like we had a quadratic function shifted over here, and we are seeing this part of the quadratic function beyond t equal to zero when we started our stopwatch or video. When we solve kinematic problems, we're just using combinations of these equations as appropriate for each type of motion, and importantly, while ensuring the correct signs and initial values. Now, I've shown the relationships simply using slopes. And while these kinematic equations can be very eloquently derived using calculus, I'll show that we can derive one of the key kinematic equations using basic algebra in order to demonstrate the other direction of the relationships, namely areas. Here we have a graph of velocity versus time for constant acceleration, but starting with an initial velocity of v0 that isn't zero. Let's look at the total area under the curve by finding the area of the rectangle, which is v0 times t, and the area of the triangle, which is 1 half v minus v0 times t. Stealing from the above equation for the definition of acceleration, we can make a substitution for the v minus v naught, and we arrive at the quadratic equation for displacement as a function of time. So effectively, we've shown that the area under the VT, or velocity time curve, gives us displacement. Likewise, the area under the acceleration time graph gives the change in velocity. And I'll leave it to you to figure out what equation would come from the area under this VT graph and how it is different from the one from the last slide. From these relationships, we have equations 1 and 3 for objects moving with constant acceleration. And equations 2 and 4 simply come from reworking these to eliminate acceleration or time, depending on what problem we're faced with. If you're struggling to remember the equations for functions like quadratics or the quadratic formula, I suggest this site at the bottom for review. Now let's look at some examples and problems using these equations in the next videos.